Summa mysterium yea, there is that which is the end of understanding, but that which thou must understand with flower of mind. For shouldst thou turn thy mind inwards on it, and understand it as understanding something, thou shalt not understand it. For that there is a power of the mind's prime, that shineth forth in all directions, flashing with intellectual rays lit. Sectors. Yet, in good sooth, thou shouldst not strive with vehemence to understand that end of understanding, nor even with the wide-extended flame of wide-extended mind, that measures all things, except that end of understanding only. Indeed there is no need of strain in understanding this, but thou shouldst have the vision of thy soul in purity, turned from aught else, so as to make thy mind empty of all things else, attentive to that end, in order that thou mayest learn that end of understanding, for it subsists beyond the mind. Mystic Union. For mind is not without the that which makes it mind, and that which is the end of mind doth not subsist apart from mind. The one desirable. For from the paternal source naught that's imperfect spins or wheels. The father doth not so fear, but pours forth persuasion, not knowing that God is wholly good. O wretched slaves, be sober. The soul of men shall press God closely to itself, with naught subject to death in it, but now it is all drunk, for it doth glory in the harmony that is, the sublunary or fate spheres beneath whose sway the mortal frame exists. The divine triad from thee is Father, and through thee Mother I bid. 146. And, for power is with him, but mind from him the Father withdrew himself, yet shut not up his own peculiar fire within its Gnostic power. God nurturing silence, nurturer of the divine, mind of mind. For he the Father doth not inlock his fire transcendent, the primal fire, his power, into matter by means of works, but by energy of mind. For it is mind of mind who is the architect of this the manifested fiery world. The Father outperfected all, and gave them over to his second mind, whom ye, all nations of mankind, sing of as first. The monad and dyad. The dyad hath his seat with him the Father, for he hath both power to master things intelligible or ideal, and also to induce the sense of feeling in the world of form. All things have for their Father the one fire. He is the all-embracing lit, wide-stretching monad who begets the two, the one body of all things. From both of these monad and dyad there flows the body of the three, first yet not first, for it is not by it that things intelligible are measured. Once beyond and twice beyond, mid the Father is the center of Hecate circles. About the hollows beneath the ribs of her right side there spouts, full bursting, forth the fountain of the primal soul, all at once ensuing light, fire, ether, worlds. After the Father's thinkings, you must know, I, the soul, dwell, making all things to live by heat. On the left side of Hecate is a fountain of virtue, remaining entirely within, not sending forth its pure virginity. And from her back, on either side the goddess, boundless nature hangs. Her hair seems like a mane of light to bristle piercingly. Ray, in sooth, is both the fountain and the flood of the blessed knowing ones. For she it is who first receives the Father's powers into her countless bosoms, and poureth forth on everything birth dash and death, that spins light to a wheel. All things are triple the mind of the Father, uttered the word, that all should be divided, or cut into three. His will nodded assent, and at once all things were so divided. He who governs all things with the mind of the Eternal, in every cosmos there shineth, or is manifested a triad, of which a monad is source. All things are served in the gulfs of the triad from this triad the Father mixed every spirit. arming both mind and soul with triple might. Ye who, understanding, know the paternal depth cosmos transcending. It is all things, but intelligibly all. That which cannot be cut up, the holder together of all sources. Source of all sources, one that holds all things together. She is the energizerlet. Workwoman and forth giver of life bringing fire. Flows fresh and fresh, or on and on into the wombs of things. The life-giving might of fire possessed of mighty power. Eon doctrine for he the eon alone, culling unto its fall the flower of mine the son from out the father's might the mother, possesseth both the power to understand the father's mind, and to bestow that mind both on all sources and upon all principles, both power to understand our world, and ever bide upon his never-tiring pivot. The utterance of the fire. Thence there leaps forth the genesis of matter manifoldly wrought in varied colours. Thence the fire flash down streaming dims its fair flower of fire, as it leaps forth into the wombs of worlds. For thence all things begin downwards to shoot their admirable rays. Limit the separator. For from him leap forth both thunderings inexorable, and the fire-flash receiving bosoms of the all-fiery radiance of Father-begotten Hecate, and that by which the flower of fire, and mighty breath beyond the fiery poles is girt. Just as a diaphragm hyperscos, an owing membrane, he divides the mind of the Father, vehicled in rare draws of straight lines, flashing inflexibly in furrows of implacable fire. The emanation of ideas. The Father's mind forth bubbled, conceiving, with his will in all its prime, ideas that can take upon themselves all forms, and from one source they, taking flight, sprang forth. For from the Father was both will and end. These were made differentiate by Gnostic fire, allotted into different knowing modes. For the world of many forms, the king laid out an intellectual plan or type not subject unto change. Kept to the tracing of this plan, that no world can express, the world, made glad with the ideas, that take all shapes, grew manifest with form. Of these ideas there is one only source, from which there bubble forth in differentiation other ones, that no one can approach. Forth bursting round the bodies of the world, which circle round its or inspiring depths or bosoms, like unto swarms of bees, flashing around them and about, incuriously, some hither and some thither, the Gnostic thoughts from the paternal source, that cull unto their fall the flower of fire at height of sleepless time. 66 It was the Father's first self-perfect source, that welled forth these original ideas. Thoughts of the Father. Brightness of flame, pure fire. The bond of love divine. For the self-begotten one, the Father mind, perceiving his own works, stood into all love's bond, that with his fire o'ermast us all, so that all might continue loving on for endless time, and that these weavings of the Father's Gnostic light might never fail. With this love too, it is the elements of cosmos keep on running. With the bond of admirable love, who leaped forth first, clothed round with fire, his fellow bound to him, that he might mix the mixing bowls original, by pouring in the flower of his own fire. Having mingled the spark of soul with twin unanimity, with mind and breath divine, to them he added, as a third, pure love. The august master binding all. Virtue and wisdom and deliberate certainty. The seven firmaments. The Father caused to swell forth seven firmaments of worlds. The centers of the hylic world are fixed in the ether above it. The true sun. The true sun. As to the sun, the tradition handed on a mysterious doctrine that cannot now be completely recovered in the absence of the original text. Proclus, however, 76 tells us, that the real sun, as distinguished from the visible disk, was transmundane or supercosmic, that is, beyond the worlds visible to the senses. In other words, it belonged to the light world proper, the monadic cosmos, and poured forth thence its fountains of light. The tradition of the most arcane or mystic of the oracles, he tells us, was that the sun's wholeness, i.e., monad, was to be sought on the transmundane plane K32, C130, for there, he says, is the solar cosmos and the whole light, as the oracles of the Chaldeans say, and I believe K33. Elsewhere he speaks of what appears to be the circuit of the sun, and contrasts this with its true circulation, which, proceeding from above somewhence, from out the hidden and supercelestial ordering of things beyond the heavens, sows into all the suns in cosmos the proper portion of their light for each. This also seems to have been based on the doctrine of the oracles. 77 As the informing mind was called mind of mind, so was the true sun called in the oracles time of time, because it measures all things with time, as Proclus tells us. And this time is, of course, the aeon. It was also called fire, sluice of fire, and also fire disposer K33, C133, and, we may add, by many another name connected with fire, as we learn from the Mithriac ritual, the moon. If the visible sun, as we have seen, was not the true sun, equally so must we suppose the visible moon to be an image of the true moon reflected in the atmosphere of gross matter. Concerning the moon we have these five scattered shreds of fragments. Both the ethereal course and the measureless rush, and the aerial floods or fluxes of the moon. O either, sun, moon's breath, leaders of air, both of the solar circles and lunar pulsings and aerial bosoms. The melody of either and of sun, and of the streams of moon and air, and wide air, and lunar course, and the ethereal vault of Sunday the elements. From what remains we learn, as Proclus tells us, that the sun space came first, then the moon space, and then the air space. The elements of cosmos, however, were not simply our earthy fire, air, water, and earth, but of a greater order. The Olympiodorus tells us that the elements at the highest point 79 of the earth, that is on the tops of the highest mountains, were also thought of as elements of cosmic water, as it were watery air, and this air in its turn was moist ether, while ether itself was the uttermost ether. It was in that state that were to be sought the ethers of the elements proper, as the oracles call them the shells of the cosmic egg. The diagrammatic representation of cosmic limit was a curve, whether hyperbolic, parabolic, or elliptical we do not know. Damasius, quoting from the oracles, speaks of it as a single line, drawn out in a curved or convex outline, or figure, and adds that this figure was frequently used in the oracles K34. It signified the periphery of heaven. In the Orphic mythology, doubtless based on Chaldean sources, the dome of heaven is fabled to have been formed out of the upper shell of the great egg, when it broke in twain. The egg in its 80 upper half was sphere-like, in its lower conical or elliptical. Proclus tells us that the oracles taught that there were 7 circuits or rounds of the irregular or imperfect spheres, and in addition the single motion of the 8th, or perfect sphere which carried the whole heaven round in the contrary direction towards the west. The physiology of the cosmic body. To this 8th sphere we must refer the progression, spoken of in the verses both lunar course and star progression. This star progression was not delivered from the womb of things because of the envith, and in the midst, another fire is loose, whence the life-bringing fire descendeth to the hilar channels. The center, from which all, raised to the periphery, are equal. The globular cosmos from fire, from water, earth, and all nourishing either. Yea, for there was a second massive fire working of its own self all things below lit. There, in order that the cosmic body might be wound into a ball, in order that cosmos might be made plainly manifest, and not appear as membrane-like, do not soil the spirit, nor turn the plane into the solid. For it is a copy of mind. But that which is brought forth, or engendered has something of body. For nature that doth never tire, rules over worlds and works, in order that the heaven may run its course for aye, down drawn, and the swift sun, around its centre, that custom wise he may return. The principles or laws of the sensible world, yea, verily, full armed within and armed without, lie to a goddess. Principles which, perceiving in their minds the works thought in the Father's mind, clothe them about with works and bodies, that the sense can apprehend. Among them the first course is the sacred one, and in the midst the airy, third is another one which warms the earth in fire. For all things are the slaves of these three mighty principles.